So confident of God's love for Jeannie, confident of God's love for you, and confident of his presence among us, let us pray. Almighty God and Father, it is our certain faith that your Son who died on the cross was raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. Grant that through this mystery, your servant Jeannie, who has gone to her rest in Christ, may share in the joy of his resurrection. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. This time I invite you to please be seated as we listen to God's word. I'd like to invite our first reader to please come forward.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. There is an appointed time for everything, and a time for every affair under the heavens. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to uproot the plant. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to tear down, and a time to build. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them. A time to embrace, and a time to be far from embraces. A time to seek, and a time to lose. A time to keep, and a time to cast away. A time to rend, and a time to sow. A time to be silent, and a time to speak. A time to love, and a time to hate. A time of war, and a time of peace. What profit have workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to mortals to be busy about. God has made everything appropriate to its time, but has put the timeless into their hearts so they cannot find out, from the beginning to end, the work which God has done. I recognize that there is nothing better than to rejoice and to do well during life. Moreover, that all can eat and drink and enjoy the good of all their toil. This is a gift of God. I recognize that whatever God does will endure forever. There is no adding to it or taking from it. Thus, God has done that he may be revered. What now is has already been, what is to be already is. God retrieves what has gone by. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On one occasion, Jesus spoke thus, I give praise to you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth. For although you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned, you revealed them to the childlike. Yes, Father, such has been your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wishes to reveal him. Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart, and you will find rest for yourselves, for my yoke is easy, and my burden light. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise be seated. Today's gospel passage can be broken down into two main messages. Messages that are designed to give you a sense of peace and comfort during this time of your pain and sorrow. In the first part of the gospel passage, Jesus is telling his disciples, and therefore all of us, that we must be childlike if we are to understand the fullness of God's love. And what I think that Jesus was saying was that young children understand the concept of unconditional love in a way that we, as many adults, simply cannot do. Since young children see themselves as being at the very center of everything that happens, they just expect to be loved. From a young child's perspective, the world completely revolves around them, and therefore they lack the self-doubt that many adults feel. Little children both receive and give unconditional love with abandon. Love simply comes very naturally to them. It's only when kids get a little bit older and ready for school that we see them losing some of that confidence. And unfortunately, as many of us grow older, we become more aware of our own faults and our own failings. However, the love that God has for Jean and for you and for me is that unconditional love that young children understand so well. And that means that this is not an end for Jean, but rather a new beginning. That we believe that Jean has now been raised up to be with God and his kingdom. That Jean now knows the fullness of God's love, the fullness of God's forgiveness, and the fullness of everlasting life. And while it's always very easy for you to understand that, of course, Jeannie is in heaven because she was such a wonderful and caring person, there's that message of unconditional love that applies to you as well. Because one time your time of pain and suffering will come to an end. And on that day, you will be reunited with your wife and your mother, your grandmother, your great-grandmother, and your friend. As we gather here today, we believe that Jeannie is being rewarded for her life of love and service here on earth. And one day, you will be together again. The second part of the gospel passage is that we are all called to take the yoke of the Lord upon our shoulders. And what that means in a very real way is to do the Lord's work. That does not mean that this is a labor for us, but rather a recognition that God works through us. I have never heard God speak to me and a thunderous voice has come down from heaven. But I have heard God speak to me in the silence of prayer and also in the words and actions of others. We know that Jeannie was born to be a mother and a grandmother. You will hear some wonderful stories from her son Joe after communion this afternoon. And many of those stories are going to revolve around what a wonderful mother and grandmother that she was. And so I believe that God revealed to us and the way that Jeannie demonstrated her unconditional love for you. And I believe that you were able to gain a glimpse into the greatness of God's love through Jeannie's words and through her actions and through her love of you. We know that Jeannie was a wonderful wife to Dan, that they loved to laugh together, that they loved to travel together, that they simply loved being together. And it was rewarding to hear about those wonderful trips they took to Ireland and Germany and France, and of course, many vacation spots here in the United States. And I believe that Jeannie was revealing to you the presence of God and the way that she taught you to be adventurous, and the way that she was able to take those trips, the way that they were able to go and do these wonderful, remarkable things, taught each of you an important lesson. I believe that these are things that God wants to reveal to us. And I believe that Jeannie was the perfect vehicle for those lessons. God wants us to be truly happy. And in so many ways, Jean showed you how. I also believe that God calls us to make others happy, not in a reluctant or a begrudgingly way, but rather in the way that Jeannie helped to make others happy. She truly enjoyed taking an interest in others. She very clearly went out of her way to make others happy, but those efforts made her happy as well. She was skillful in wanting to learn about you. When she was talking to you, it was very clear that you were the most important person in the world. That is the joyful work of the Lord and not a burden. Jeannie also taught you how to be creative, how to start hobbies that brought you joy. I believe that God wants us to use the gifts of creativity in a way that can be fun, in a way that can be energizing. And I believe that that's why Jean's Christmas Eve parties were so special, because she allowed the creative juices to flow in putting on these spectacular events for you. These were wonderful events because she put her heart and her soul into making them so special, because you were special and she wanted you to know that. And finally, Jeannie taught you the importance of prayer. God wants us to be a prayerful people because it is prayer that gives us a peace of heart. That is something that Jean understood so well. The comfort that prayer could offer her. The comfort that only prayer can provide. Jean's example of faithfulness and devotion was a reminder that prayer is not an obligation, but rather a resource. Her ability to stay positive, her ability to focus on others, her ability to be creative and fun and life-giving was a result of her willingness to allow God to penetrate her heart. You gather here today to mourn the loss of a very special person, a person who is now at rest in God's kingdom, but she has not only been raised up to be with God, but she's also been raised up to be in your hearts. And so I encourage you to tell the stories of her life and love. I encourage you to remember her spirit of optimism. I encourage you to remember her desire to make others feel special and loved and cared about. And as you remember the stories of her life and love, you will know that you are loved by her. You will know that you are loved by God. And you will know that you will be together again in God's kingdom. At this time, I invite us to please stand as we bring forth our prayers and petitions. I'd like to invite our petition readers to please come forward.
pray for Baba. In baptism, she died with Christ. May she now share in the fullness of his resurrection. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of all consolation, help us to comfort one another in our grief, finding light in time. We pray for all those we have loved who have died, especially Baba's parents, William and Eleanor, and her nephew, Charlie. Lord, give them reward of their goodness. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For solidarity in a global human family, that we may work together to protect those who are most vulnerable and most in need. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may learn to honor diversity in race, ethnicity, language, culture, and life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our elected officials that they strive to work for fair education, adequate housing, access to health care, and equal opportunity to all. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for those here today that are memory of Baba, Grandma, whom we love, inspires us with a renewed love for all our sisters and brothers. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Loving God, we ask you to hear the prayers of your faithful gathered here today, the prayers spoken aloud, and those lying deep within our hearts. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And I invite you to please be seated as we prepare our gifts.
Right and just.
It is truly right, just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy God, and Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, for as one alone he accepted death, that we might all escape from dying. As one like us he chose to die, so that in your sight we might all live forever. And so in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. Holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. And to your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power of the working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather people to yourself, so that in the rising of the sun to its setting, a perfect sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. And in a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving his holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one Spirit in Christ. May make of us an eternal offering to you, that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the glorious martyrs, and all the saints under his constant intercession. In your presence we rely on unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth. With your servant Francis, our Pope, Blaise, our Bishop, the order of bishops, clergy, the religious, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you, and your compassionate, merciful God, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant, Jeannie, whom you have called from this world to herself. Grant that she, who is united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. When from the earth, you will raise up from the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed sisters and brothers, and to all who are pleasing to you, that their passing from this life give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe every tear from our eyes, for seeing you our God as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Now invite us to stand at the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity, in accordance with your will, to live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. I now invite us to extend this sign of peace during this pandemic. We ask you to do so by please waving to those who are not living in the same household.
You know what?
Keep your mask over your nose and your mouth. Come forward with everyone receiving the Eucharist in the hand. Please put out a hand. And then as you turn and get about 4 or 6 feet away, use your free hand to lower your mask. Receive the Eucharist and place your mask back in place. After I finish distributing communion to this section over here, I'll cross over and I'll get this section. I would like to remind you that no one should feel obligated to receive the Eucharist during this time. If you'd like, you can either remain in your pews or come forward, putting your arms across your chest, and you will receive a special blessing. We certainly want everybody to feel that we're doing things in a very safe and responsible way. I apologize for having to make this announcement, but it is in all of our best interest to follow the guidelines and policies set by the Archdiocese. I invite you now to please kneel. My sisters and brothers, behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. Symphony. Quite frankly, I get that. But how could Mom not see something so obvious? That by the only metrics that mattered, Mom was no doubt an amazing mother. She made each of us know every day that we were loved. Her secret, Mom really cared, and she was as genuine as they come. Mom married when she was 21 years old. She had her first child a little over a year and had four by the time she was 26. Needless to say, she had very little time to do anything but chase kids, especially considering that her dad was more of a constant source of disruption than help. Mom did not demand order or strict discipline, as evidenced by the times Steve wheeled the metal waiting pool up and down Pleasant Avenue like a giant hamster wheel. At times I rode our neighbor's homemade motorbike around the neighborhood. Or the multiple times, and I'm emphasizing here, multiple times, we used the cigarette lighter in our Ford stationery in our little circles in the bottom of the dashboard of the car. A couple of times, probably right here in this parking lot. I don't remember any of us ever getting in trouble with her. Not even the hell's bells. That was the phrase she used when we knew she was really happy. As kids, most of us paid little attention to any effort to help keep the house in order. There were several occasions when we were young, where Mom instituted the sap box. It was a box of all toys that were left out and be deposited until the next day. I don't recall ever any toy being deposited in the box. We did, of course, as kids, misbehave from time to time. However, when it really mattered, the thing that motivated us to do right was this tacit understanding that we couldn't disappoint someone who loved us so much. And besides, Mom led by example and made sure we always understood the importance of thinking of others. Mom gave everything she had to her children. She would often drive on my big routes. She would run out last minute to come obtain school supplies, even though we didn't bring them up until the very last minute. And she would stay up late typing papers when needed. When she needed to rest, Mom would nap on the couch in the living room. These naps were interrupted with at least one of us nestling in close to her, sometimes fighting over the best spot. Mom never sent us away. She waited patiently until we were settled and she could get anything that resembled a nap. I would be remiss to not mention the trip we took to Six Flags in St. Louis. Somehow our parents had gotten passes or tickets to this brand new state-of-the-art amusement park. We were excited beyond belief. Our dad decided to ask her that he was not going to go. That one of us showed signs of the stomach. Mom was not going to let us down. We were too excited. She loaded the five of us, she was pregnant with Sarah at the time, into the car and took us herself. That night, we all packed into the motel room, piled up on Mom as we slept. Needless to say, she ended up getting miserably sick. But she took us to the park anyway. The only ride that Mom could ride that day was a slow-moving train. She brought us back to the park the next day, still feeling ill. The rest of us took our turn getting sick after riding home. Man, was it a fun trip. To help make ends meet, Mom attempted multiple potential careers. There were the stints with World Book Encyclopedia, Amway, and substitute teaching, all while pursuing her master's degree. She settled for a time in real estate where she met Dan, who she married in 1991. Mom and Dan were a great match. They enjoyed so much together and shared so many laughs, often at their own expense. Their love for each other was obvious and a joy to witness. Even as mom's health faded at the end, there was an obvious sparkle when Danny entered the room. One thing mom was not a skilled cook. Her specialty was a dish she dubbed delicious stuff, a spaghetti casserole with an amazing meat sauce, and whatever vegetables happened to be on hand. This was more or less in marketing to kids than home cuisine. When I was away at college, I had trouble understanding why home-cooked meal was such a lure for others to return home. But even though mom's cooking wasn't her forte, she happily hosted Thanksgiving, Christmas, and multiple birthdays regularly up until her condition worsened and COVID got in the way. She never worried much about such things as the right fork in the right place. If it had to have times, it would do. That wasn't the important part. Mom was more vested in having family there and making sure that there was a spot for anyone who wanted to join. She put so much effort preparing Christmas Eve at the Christmas Eve open house. As our Aunt Marilyn noted in a recent post, anyone seeing how happy mom was with everyone around the table would know that she was in her element. The table was always filled with good cheer. At these gatherings, mom always gathered her glass of red wine, a symbol of family and friends enjoying time together. And as that glass emptied, mom would ask for just a half glass. Because, it seems, a half glass doesn't really count. Even when there was more than one just half, and especially on Christmas Eve. After mom retired from real estate, she worked at Weight Watchers, helping with weigh-ins and other work with clients. She loved that job because she got to meet so many people and loved talking to them. One of the clients shared that mom was her favorite because she always had a friendly smile and never said anything when a meal went the wrong way. Another shared that mom sent her flowers to congratulate her for reaching her goal. Mom had immediate fondness for anyone who was from the South Side, anyone who was a Cubs fan, and anyone who was a Democrat. The women Democrats could always count on her vote. I still remember the giant gin bird sign that overtook our front yard. Above all else, if you were Irish, you could do no wrong. The truth is, mom found good in everyone. She genuinely cared about people. Mom gave so much of herself to us kids, it would seem impossible that she had more to give than the grandchildren came. You see, mom loved her children in spite of the difficulty, our difficulties and flaws. Apparently, her grandchildren were flawless. If they ever wanted to play dog, then it was time to get down on all fours and bark. If they wanted to mix Halloween figures with your Christmas village, then that just made the village better. Whenever I asked about grandchild's game, show, or event, mom would always earnestly describe them as being so good. Grandma and Baba adored each and every one of her grandchildren, and they adored her. For Christmas, she spent hours making each a personal gift, such as blankets, pajamas, jackets, and many others. Every Easter, she would set out eggs for an Easter egg hunt and send baskets to the grandchildren around the town. For birthdays, grandchildren would always be given a lunch with Grandma or Baba. The kids always looked forward to it, mostly because they could count on mom's undivided attention. It wasn't just the lunches, though. Mom always made time for her grandchildren, and they were always eager to talk to her. Mom regularly scheduled FaceTime calls with the kids, and God forbid we ever interrupt one of those FaceTime calls. Mom also enjoyed activities such as embroidery, needlepoint, and knitting classes with her grandchildren. There were countless times that I was able to catch up on my own kids by talking to mom. I said that mom always felt good in everyone, and I have to admit, that's not completely true. But this brings me to the other thing that mom said that I wanted to share. This was on January 16th, and mom asked what day was it. I told her it was Saturday. She said, no, what's the date? I told her it was the 16th. Mom asked, what day is the 20th? Despite her failing health, Mom remained keenly tuned into inauguration day. Leading up to the election, she completed countless postcards encouraging people to vote. But this time it wasn't political. It was more about the man, the fact that the man who was leading was the antithesis of everything that Mom stood for. Honesty, generosity, selflessness, empathy, caring, fairness, and forgiveness for all others. Mom, you were an amazing mother. You're the most significant and positive influence in our lives. You're an amazing mama, an amazing grandma, an amazing wife, an amazing sister, aunt, cousin, and friend. We will miss you dearly, but we will forever cherish your company.
Ladies and gentlemen, before we conclude our mass for Jean this afternoon, on behalf of Dan, Jean Children, I'd like to extend their appreciation to Father Sullivan for celebrating the mass here at Christ the King. I'd also like to thank all of you, their family and friends, for joining them here today in church or watching this live stream wherever you may be. When mass concludes and Father recesses from church, I will ask you to follow. But I'd also like to remind you that if you would please sign the registration sheets in the back of church for the church marriage. Once again, recessing from church, please sign the registration sheets today. Thank you.
Yeah, I'd just like to take a moment to thank you for that very beautiful reflection. It certainly helps us to celebrate your mom's life and her tremendous love for all of you. Dan, I'd just like to take an opportunity to thank you for welcoming me into your home. It was really a pleasure to get to know you and Jeannie. It was a pleasure to be able to spend some time with you and also realize just what a wonderful person that Jean was. Those were just a wonderful, wonderful occasions. Would not be possible if you hadn't invited me into your home multiple occasions, so thank you very much. Please know that you will remain in our prayers throughout this coming year. I know these are very difficult times with the pandemic, and it's so difficult to really adequately express your sorrow to each other, but know that you are in our prayers. I invite you to please stand for our final blessing. The Lord be with you, with your spirit. Now, mighty God, the Son is blessed upon you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us go in peace and love to serve the Lord and one another. Thanks be to God. Mm-hmm.